Gopijana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Vrajajana Ranjana. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopijana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tiravanacha Hari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Radha Gopinath Radha Gopinath Radhe. Jaya Gauranitai Jaya Gauranitai Gauranitai Jaya Gauranitai. Jaya Shri Gopal Jaya Shri Gopal Jaya Shri Gopal Jaya Shri Gopal Jaya. Jaya Jaya Prabhupad 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 Prabhupad. Jaya Jaya Gurudev, 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 Gurudev. Lord Premanandi. Jaya Vishnupath Paramahansa Parivachakacharya Stotrata Shri Srimad's Divine Grace. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur ki jai. Prem se kaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadha, Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopinath Shyam Kund Radha Kund Giri Govardhan ki jai. Vrindavan Mathura Dham ki jai. Navadvip Mayapur Dham ki jai. Bhakti Devi ki jai. Tulsi Devi ki jai. Samaveda Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirae. Nashta Praeshu Abhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki. We are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 17, Text number 10, Chapter entitled Description of the Varnashram System. Adho Krita Yuge Varno Nenam Hamsa Iti Smrita Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Ado Krita Yuge Varno Nenam Hamsa Iti Smrita Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Adau Krita Yuge Varno Ninam Hamsa Iti Smrita Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Adau Krita Yuge Varno Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Adho Krita Yuge Varno Ninam Hamsa Iti Smita Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Adho Krita Yuge Varno Nanam Hamsa Iti Smita Krita Kritya Praja Jatya Tasmat Krita Yugam Vidu Mataji? Adho, in the beginning of the millennium, Krita Yuge, in the Satya Yuga, or age of truth, Varna, the social class, Ninam, of human beings, Hamsa, named Hamsa, Iti, thus, Smrita, well known, Krita Kritya, perfect in the execution of duties by complete surrender to the Supreme Lord. Praja, the citizens. Jatya, automatically by birth. Tasmat, therefore. Krita Yugam, Krita Yuga, or the age in which all duties are fulfilled. Vidu was thus known by the learned. Translation and purport by the humble disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. translation. In the beginning, in Satya Yuga, there is only one social class called Hamsa, to which all human beings belong. In that age, all people are unalloyed devotees of the Lord from birth, and thus learned scholars call this first age Krita Yuga, or the age in which all religious duties are perfectly fulfilled. Purport. It is understood from this verse that the supreme religious principle is unalloyed surrender to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In Satya Yuga, there is no influence of the lower modes of nature, and therefore, all human beings belong to the highest social order called Hamsa, in which one comes under the direct supervision of the Personality of Godhead. In the modern age, people are crying out for social equality, but unless all human beings are situated in the mode of goodness, which is the position of purity and unalloyed devotion, social equality is not possible. As the lower modes of nature becomes prominent, secondary religious principles arise, by which people may be gradually elevated to the pure stage of unalloyed surrender to Krishna, to God. In Satya Yuga, there are no inferior human beings, and thus there is no need of secondary religious principles. Everyone directly takes to the unalloyed service of the Lord, fulfilling perfectly all religious obligations. In Sanskrit, one who perfectly executes all duties is called Krita Kritya, as mentioned in this verse. Therefore, Satya Yuga is called Krita Yuga, or the age of perfect religious action. According to Srila Jiva Goswami, the word Adau, in the beginning, refers to the moment of universal creation. In other words, the Varnashram system is not a recent concoction, but naturally arises at the time of creation and should therefore be accepted by all intelligent human beings. Om Agyan Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakhaya Chakshurun Melitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Gurum Shri Uta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha E Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Apta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhuva Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatarine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shivas Adi Gaur Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So in today's verse, there is a very interesting statement which is made by, in the purport, that social equality is not possible. In this age, why? Because the there is no Krishna in the center. So this really sums up the the cause of the problems, means the what is the problem in the world, in one statement actually, that why we see so much with so-called advancement also happening in technology, education. In one sense, there is progress, but in the larger sense, why do we see, people are bewildered when they see that there are so many problems that are increasing. If you just take 50 years ago and now, practically any sphere, we have heard many times, you know, there's been one Back to Godhead magazine which had come out and quoted statistics of 1950s, what US school-going children, what were the main problems that time, the top 10 problems, and then what the problems are in the 90s and the year 2000 and odd. And there's a radical change. That time the issues were making noise in class, putting chewing gum under the chair, things like that. And now it is guns and drugs and so on. It's a complete change. Crime statistics, you know, you can see the kind of... So there is a lot of inequality also. So there is a... So it would be very bewildering unless we see it from the eyes of the Shastra, which tells us that unless we actually unify in Krishna's purpose, I mean, what Krishna wants, because he is the creator, that means we have to first accept that there is... that we belong to somebody, we are beholden to someone. Someone has made us, means for, we are like how a child doesn't understand anything, a newborn child, even in an infancy or even in its teens, wouldn't understand exactly, they just accept what it is, they just come here and then but they know that they have parents and then they are beholden to the parents. So here, the only problem is that we don't accept our parents. We don't accept that material nature is our mother, and this whole Srishti is created by Krishna. Though he repeatedly says this, but not accepting his word causes the real imbalance. And that imbalance completely pushes us into a totally different life. Because that's the, you see, it's like, if you take the first step, you know, if you have two, three options on the ground floor, and if you go into the wrong building, and then you may climb up 50 floors, but you're going to climb the wrong way. So basically, you have to take, the direction has to be based on a main sound principle, and that is the acceptance of Krishna or God in whatever way we call him. So not accepting him creates all kinds of inequalities. And therefore, conversely, spiritual life brings equality. Now, we shouldn't rush into thinking that, well, I have joined a spiritual organization, I am spiritual, and therefore... we may find, and we will find, that because individually we have our weaknesses, we may have moments of weaknesses, we may have long periods of weaknesses, and we may be at times not acting on that same behalf. But we do see people who actually act on that behalf and who actually see how everybody is equal. We have seen Srila Prabhupada, that is, we may not have physically seen him, but everyone in this room would think that he knows Prabhupada better than he probably knows many of his relatives. We do feel that because we have heard, we constantly hear about him. And when you see someone in that, we don't even know our mother and father to that microscopic event as we know Srila Prabhupada's life. And in through all that, we've seen his, not only his purity, but also his complete acceptance of Krishna in all aspects. And therefore, because of that, the corollary is that he accepts everybody as equal. So make no distinction of caste, creed, color, whatever. So that is the... Therefore, even though we may be struggling on that level, but we should not lose faith, knowing that that is the only way that... that we can strive to see that. And we have many signs of it. For instance, when you come to satsang programs, you come to the temple and are sitting here, never ever in any temple, right now it must be going on in 800 centers around the world, nowhere would even the thought be arising that the person next to me is from which state, which language, which caste, or which background, which... That doesn't make at all any difference. The thought only doesn't cross our minds. So we see this in reality, that actually the practice of spiritual life is a very unifying factor in the real sense. Because Krishna is in the center, Radha Gopinath ji owns the place and we are his servants, servants of his servants. And we take the guidance of his special emissaries. And because of that, we do find a very peaceful atmosphere. To the extent that we follow that, we find this principle very open to us. To the extent that, if we are overcome by our ego or anger and other weaknesses, we will be distracted and we will be seeing it in a different way. And therefore, our behavior also changes. Similarly, we have counselor meetings or we go to yatras. We have various services. Now, we're serving the highest, the deities are the highest principle in the world. But in our temple and every temple and any spiritual organization which is genuine, nobody distinguishes who does deity worship. There is nothing, it is just the standards are really of the person's humility and sincerity, the person's attitude towards accepting spiritual life. That's the only consideration. Right, so it is. So there is nothing external; it is only an internal. So we do see glimpses of this all around us, and therefore we can conclude that spiritual life, spiritual organization, is really what, is the only factor. Spiritual life is the only factor which can bring us to the social equality status. And the irony is that today, if you see. It is a well-known fact that all over the world, most of media, etc., in the name of so-called liberalism, anything to do even remotely with religion, they have a complete phobia. So while they talk of intolerance, but actually the most intolerant behavior generally is that they can't accept other people's faith. And what is the proof of that? Because they constantly talk about, like in India, there's a huge always a discussion about caste system. You see these headlines that so-and-so, two people from this caste were killed and so on. There is a huge... So certainly caste system is a very perverse reflection the way we see it today. But if that is the case, if they are so worried about that, then it would be very simple to just look at, and in all fairness, look at an organization like ISKCON or any other organization and say that this is one organization which is actually following the highest principle of unity. Do we ever even hear one mention of it? There is the United Nations, which is supposed to bring all countries together. And actually, more countries have been created and divided after United Nations came on. So we see that the United Nations, it is only in name, but and it is used for different reasons. But at least while the struggles go on, to accept that there is somewhere something is happening, which is actually, whether in this country or any other country, but that is not accepted. So that is the irony that unfortunately that... there are examples of where these principles could actually be, are being followed of what the world wants. Today the world wants peace, the world wants unity. Prabhupada gave them the peace formula when he was in front of the United Nations and he said, Bhuktaram, Yaga Tapasam, just follow this. And if you accept Krishna, the center of everything and the owner of everything, proprietor, then really there will be peace. But people laughed. But we are seeing that, though he said it 50 years ago, we are seeing that actually that is the only way we could actually really bring things together. And therefore, we can see that Srila Prabhupada is actually a historical figure for us. Historical because he will be going down in history, not because we happen to be part of this movement. I mean, we should be grateful that we have got an opportunity, how we got this, but there are already signs that if you see the three or four most biggest issues which are facing the world and defined by them only, not defined by us, defined by what the we constantly people talk about at all levels, the highest levels, from the presidents, prime ministers to ministers to the intellectual classes. And then what was Prabhupada's response and what is the solution he gave and where do we stand today? So if there are, I'll just give four examples, and two we can take in the social cultural issues and two on the economic side. So on the social cultural side, one of the biggest issues facing is whether it's racism or casteism, tribals, distinguishing between people's different lineages. this is practically everywhere. So while we may have a caste system issue where people are divided on that basis, but like in the Australia, there's a big problem where you have aborigines. In the US you have, and the Western countries you have colors of the skin. And while they may be more sophisticated in trying to, in not exactly making it open, but nevertheless there is a constant feeling, and not just most Indians who go there also and who settle there, they do understand that there is an undertone of that. So this just happens because everyone is looking to their own to their own self, and therefore they see what is best for me. So today there is such a huge issue about anti-immigrants in each country, because they feel that more outsiders are coming in, then we are being threatened. So what is Prabhupada's response? Prabhupada only spoke of, if you summarize everything, you know, basically, very simply put, he said so many things, but if you take two basic principles, he constantly, you know, talked on and on, was that we are not this body, and Krishna is the proprietor of everything. This was the two basic things on around which he all mentioned everything. So, response to this issue also was that we are about the casteism, racism, etc. Prabhupada's response, if now put in context of today, and he said, we are not this body, and he acted on that. He had Western disciples. He followed Bhaktivinoda Thakur's dream of taking the of unifying the world on the everyone would come together singing Harinam on the streets and in the temples. He built a house in which the whole world can live. So he actually spent his entire life. He built an institution, an organization, which also is supposed to be following those principles, which are on the nothing to do on the body level, which is on the level of the soul, which is equality. So he this was a direct response. So we have a solution. We may say that there are only a few lakh people who may follow it, and then there may be some others in other religions who also follow it, certainly. But the thing is that if it is not accepted by the intelligentsia or by the highest authorities, then that's going to be a challenge. But ultimately, Krishna is in control. But we can see that Prabhupada has a solution which is not just an airy-fairy one, which is actually pragmatic, and which we can see how it can work together. Second, on the social cultural was equal rights for women. We hear so much about that. There is gone to the other extreme. So there has been so much abuse of women, so much. And it has been happening for several decades or maybe more. And now there is a kind of very strong reactions coming. But then because of that, today we see the situation that actually there is more and more exploitation. But it is more, in many ways, very subtle. So many things which are controlled by men and creating an aura in which women are getting trapped into it. But Prabhupada's response was, again, we are not this body. And also that Krishna is the only Purush, we are the Prakriti. So that really, people don't accept that statement, but it is a Shastric statement. And if you take this statement, then it answers everything. That actually, the nature of the soul is feminine, and there's only one male, which is Krishna. So which means that then we are coming up with our own drama, that today we are a man, tomorrow we may be an animal, day after we may be this, whatever, different species we have come through. We have now come to human species and we have been given different bodies. So in that, so therefore we have to have the X-ray vision to go through the external physical features and then be able to see it from the eyes of Shastra, to see that while we have duties and all based on our bodily designations, and bodily, not includes also our leanings to of what our nature is, what our inclinations are, and we'll act on that basis. But the reality is that we are all female in spirit, and actually Krishna is the only Purush. And then Prabhupada, that was the philosophy part, and then his response, he gave women so much love, so much responsibility. He really encouraged them because of their responsibility towards raising the family, unifying the family. He gave them Brahmin initiations. He stressed the fact that they have to be protected at all times. But then that has been misunderstood, because protection does not mean you're inferior. It's not a matter of inferior, superior. It's a matter of that during this, whatever designation we have, if we want to have a peace and comfort and genuine love and proper relation, then we act on that basis. It is according to the bodily designation that we have that we need to act. So this protection is meant because you normally protect something which is very valuable. You don't protect something which has no value. So when we say there's a need for protection, and especially in today's world, we can see how critical it is. And I remember there was one, when there was a very horrible incident happened some years ago, which became world news, a very brutal assault. At that time, one very senior lady, she was heading a women's organization, and she came out and a few days later, and she made a statement that it would be better also, if women, especially when they don't stay out too late in the nights, and that they wear a little modestly when they go out in the evenings particularly. And the backlash that was there, it was as if this woman had created more crimes than Adolf Hitler. It was unbelievable how much everybody revolted. Everybody means, of course, it's just again the, because it's basically the ones who write the news, then. So it was as if what she said was very normal, and she gave a very, it was like a mother telling, the daughters. They said, how can you, how can this woman, they demanded an apology, how can she tell what we should do, how we should lead our life, this, that. So in the name of independence, it is utter foolishness. So when we talk of intelligence, there's a difference between being intelligent and being smart. Smartness is something which today we see people are smarter today than before. But I never subscribe to the view that people are more intelligent or children are more intelligent today than before. They were much more wise. The women of 50 years ago, I used to, sometimes make fun of my mother because, they married at 16, 17, their children were 18. And I said, but then now I realize in the last 20, 30 years that at 16 they had more wisdom than today's 25, 26 year olds. They knew how to balance a household, they knew how to take care of the family, they knew how to absorb, they knew how to tolerate, they knew how to take that burden. So this was something which came beyond, it just came to them. So they knew the real truths, they knew how to keep the family going. And if the husband reciprocates, then that makes a very happy family. So this woman really, unfortunately, so is an example of how the views are that in the name of, it was as if there was a threat to their independence. It was, no, everyone has that. But see, therefore, a spiritual organization, why it is effective, because it tells us everything depends on voluntariness. Nobody has forced anyone to come here or to take up practices. Whatever we are doing is because out of conviction. So this is critical to everything that we do. So if our philosophy says that we need to be restrained, now we have to have some restraints. Like we have to, if you are spending time for chanting, which means obviously you have to cut somewhere else. If you are attending satsang programs, so many activities that may be there, if you are doing some services, it means we adjust, but it is done voluntarily. Nobody has forced us to do it. But it is when we do it voluntarily, it is done happily. So in the same way, if people take up voluntariness and understand that just having some restraint, it can solve so many problems. So this was on the, and then two economic issues which the world is facing and how, where the situation is and what Prabhupada's response. One is about poverty. So the normal theory is that poverty reduction should come by economic growth, means the company, a country should increase its activities, economic activities, what they define as gross domestic product. That's a technical word for, and they go by the percentage, how much you have increased it. But that means you have to increase and increase and increase your consumption. You have to increase investment. Investment means you have to exploit resources and you have to put it to increase so that you increase demand. So the great salesman is considered that someone who actually makes you buy something you don't want. I remember studying the example given, I often quote it that we were given that example that an ideal salesman is someone who markets, that he can sell a refrigerator to us, to an Eskimo. An Eskimo is someone who lives in the, only in snow. I mean, he doesn't need a refrigerator, but if you are able to sell it to him, means you are great. So that is called material jugglery. How you can patao someone, manao someone, you know, and manage to get it, you know, by hook or by crook, by advertising, by exciting him. And you don't care whether he or she wants it, doesn't want it, it's a waste of money, whatever. My job is done, my economic growth. So this is the principle on which the economic growth is. Rather than seeing there's a happiness or there is peace, are we satisfying our creator? Nothing. It is just right now for me, and I'm not concerned about the future. So what has that led to? Actually, that's led to greater disparity. So, well, there definitely has been enormous growth. But the growth has gone to some people. And simple statistics can just tell you that 1% of the world controls 85% of the wealth. Now, 1%, that's if you take, so 85% of the people, 85% of the wealth goes to 1%, and 15% of the wealth is for the remaining 99%. So that is a simple illustration of what the disparity is. Apart from disparity, there's also been environmental disasters, environmental worries. Suddenly there are big challenges, how we are going to cope with various aspects, you know, of the pollution and global warming and depleting resources. So it's really scrambling for a thing, but the real intelligence would be to see from the line of a visionary, someone who sees the long term. So here, someone has already set the vision. The vision is set by Krishna, because he is the one who has written, produced, directed, edited, screenplay, everything of a drama. Now we have to, somebody has to play. Imagine if the actor is brought in to play a role, and he gets so agitated, because he forgets that he's in a drama, and he's feeling that actually I'm dying, or I'm happy, or I'm, but not knowing that it's going to end in a short time. So therefore, Prabhupada gave a very simple response. He said, Krishna is a proprietor. That was his main theme. And then on the practical level, he said, simple living, high thinking, reduce your consumption. His solution to economic problem was opposite. Nobody wants to hear it, but he gave a very simple, he said, you just reduce your consumption. Instead of having four houses or three houses, you have two or one. Instead of having two issues, things you can do with one. I mean, just do what you need. Share with others. Which that principle comes out in spiritual life, that we actually like to share, whether it's prasad or whether it's our time, whether it's our resources, whatever we do, if we can share with others, if everybody was to do it, then there's no difference, because whoever's been blessed or given an opportunity in whichever environment, they can pull it together. Reduce wastage. Right? And if you see that Krishna is the owner, then you would be very concerned about not having any leakages of any sort. So this, we can, if anybody is unbiased, you can see that Srila Prabhupada's vision and view has been extremely, because it's based on Krishna and to the parampara, that is an extremely practical issue which can give us a solution. And the second issue on this, this thing is about on the economics, right, is that there is a, you can say principle of today is that education and literacy would solve all problems. That today the main problem is people are illiterate. But we are seeing that there is a huge growth of literacy. Even in India, there has been a substantial improvement. We used to be 40-45%. Now, by the literacy standards, we are maybe at around 70% or so, 65-70% overall. And some states are 95-98%. And the Western countries are naturally all in the mid or late 90s. But we just saw about the various problems that are there. So if it's not a question of literacy, it's a question of real understanding of what our situation is. Otherwise, you can be, in a narrower sense, you would understand your problem. But in the larger sense, you have missed the real goal. So actually, problems have gone up. Though there have been more PhDs or more universities, but there is a class system, because then that leads to a feeling of superiority, inferiority. If you don't have a degree, or if you have a degree, people, I find this all the time when you're talking to, just a natural conversation. Suppose you meet a person on my organization, general manager, we're talking, and he'll come and say that, sir, my son is getting married. You know, he's done his PhD from this university, or he may have just done his undergraduate, but he went to the West. So there is such a aura. But if the son or daughter has just done here, they will not bring it up. They only bring it up in connection with, you know, if it is something. So there is a value, a very high value always given, and I constantly see this. You know, if it is some Western educated, no matter if it's just an undergraduate degree, it may be not in the Ivy League, but just the Western education. So there is a phobia that we, that solves all the problem. But as we saw that the intelligence, real intelligence is, of course, if we have combined the both, as so many devotees are also doing it, that we have academic backgrounds, which helps us to understand, then we are able to study the Shastras better, able to absorb better. But at the same time, the larger principles are, spiritual principles are not dependent on the mere mundane academics. And we are seeing that there is a huge amount of proliferation all over the world for alternative education, where they do combine academics, but they're not going after degrees or they're not going after accreditations. Why? Because people want to learn, but at the same time, and hopefully if they also bring the spiritual values, then that is the best combination where they understand the realities of life, they understand how things work, the Srishti, how that is functioning, but at the same time, they also understand what the needs of the soul are. Otherwise, that may lead to an arrogance, you know, of the learned versus the illiterate. And then we see this coming out, you rarely find any principles of kindness or gentleness. These words are absent today. We rarely see this, at least in the corporate world, in the factories and so on. There's a very functional aspect of everything. There's a very cut and dried approach. There is, you know, you're only after results, but there is absolutely complete absence of selflessness, kindness, because it's not accepted. In fact, it will be seen as a major weakness. And then that leads to breakdown of families, then that leads to individualism. And what is Prabhupada's response? When Prabhupada first made the statement in the late 60s, when he called it slaughterhouse education, it really shook even the devotees, because they'd never heard this was slaughterhouse education. But what Prabhupada, so he was not against education. He never was. I mean, it didn't concern him, you know, whether he had so many very, very highly literate devotees, people who came and did enormous responsibilities, but that was incidental. Whether they came from A background or B background or C background, he was not concerned. Whatever they did, he was very, he was always happy, but he was more concerned about character development. He was more concerned about God's presence in our life. And the morality would be based on God's morality, not our mundane morality. He was more concerned with spiritual knowledge, etc. So that he put the emphasis first, and then he said the academics could follow. So basically he turned the whole world on its head. So he brought in through the Shastras who are real models, role models could be like Amrish Maharaj, Yudhishthira Maharaj, Prahlad Maharaj, Queen Kunti. Why? Because these people, these great personalities, they also had a very high level of, King Pataprudha, they had a very high level of responsibility. They discharged it very, very successfully, much more successfully than anybody today could demonstrate at all. That very efficient administration they had. By the same time, they were very concerned about every person. There was no corruption. There was great emphasis on individual people's happiness. There was a community feeling, right? So this was the way they brought so much peace over thousands of years in their reigns. When Queen Kunti said, Janmaishwarya Shruta Shibir, Edamana Madha Puman, Naiva Hatyati Abhita Tum Vai, Tvam Akinchana Gocharam, she said that Janmaishwarya Shruta Shibir means one who's plagued by false ego. So one who is really, she said that anybody who's plagued by these things, a high birth, education, wealth, it will be virtually impossible for that person to chant the holy name, to remember the Lord. And why? Because that's such a person who has so many qualities or so many attributes, gets very attractive to the rest of the world. And we do find this today. When they're very attractive to the world, then they're idolized, they're, you know, glorified to such an extent that it's very difficult to not to get proud and to feel that we haven't, it's not our attribute, it is Krishna's given. And we see this in just so many ways that people who have been blessed with it, like that brings the inequality also, because when people who have been given the attributes and they're not able to follow the principles. For instance, nowadays, one wedding, for instance, I'm taking extreme examples, but these are actual facts, that the cost of one wedding was equal to what 7 lakh families earn in 1 year. 7 lakh families in 1 year is equal to one wedding. So see that spend. So, and people see this. So therefore, it's very difficult to accept it, and then always be envy. There'll always be greed. There'll always be wrong motives. They're saying this I want, that I want. So there is an emphasis on that I need to be successful. Similarly, on beauty, looks, you know, that there's so much of material gains that you get, you know, if you really preserve your body, if you've been given attributes of good looks. Like today, movie stars, they earn 20, 25 crores per movie. And they are invited to come to attend weddings. They are paid 1 crore, you know, just to spend 2-3 hours to shake hands and to, you know, do things. So this is how, you know, but then you have to be, to preserve that. You have to really, so that when you put so much value for that, when you put value for fame, when you put value for, then you have an appeal. You have to be in the news. So there is the whole priority changes. So therefore, those who have been given this intellect, strength, you know, a few years ago there was in boxing there are different levels of weights, you know. So in the heavyweight champion, the winner and you know, they only have 3 minute bouts, 15 bouts of 3 minutes each. So that means only 45 minutes is the maximum that you box. They lose about 10 pounds in just 15, in 45 minutes. That's the kind of pounding you keep getting. But the winner got $100 million. So 700 crores for fighting 45 minutes. And apparently the loser got 50 million. He was guaranteed. And then the match ended within, I think, he was knocked out in 2 or 3 rounds or something. So there was such an uproar. They felt like, you know, they counted that per second he got it. So just to get beaten up, he was 6-8 minutes, he got $50 million. So whether he did it deliberately or not, nobody knows. But there was a lot of feeling for that. So when people have been given the attributes, and if they misuse that, then that leads to huge inequality. Family lineage also, they may be pious, but they may be talking about Khandan. Now, Khandan becomes such a big word that, you know, they have to preserve it. But then the subtle meaning is that I have to preserve. I mean, that means I am part of something special. You know, I'm a blue-blooded person, royalty, or whatever. You know, you need to, or if you have a very academically oriented family. So it becomes a special class of people. So it becomes an emphasis on taking up different priorities. So basically, as we are told that some siddhir hari toshanam, that everything that we do, all activities should be to please Hari. And if any activity which is not done to please Hari has no value. So if you follow that, then the value of someone like Shabri or Guha or Vidur, who by material standards were actually in a very lower caste, but it didn't matter because they are considered today the highest, most glorious in the entire planet and for eternal times, because the Lord appreciated them and they were very dear to them. So today is also a very special occasion because it's Advaita Acharya's appearance day. So I thought we'll just speak a few minutes. We just got maybe 7-8 minutes, so we can talk about him. So as we see that Advaita Acharya is part of the Pancha Tattva. He's the one, the extreme left, the shown with the beard. But at least I'm saying from my own experience that even after many years in the Krishna consciousness movement, it took me some time to really realize that actually, because what happens in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the first principle we know, he is Krishna. Nityanand Prabhu, that he is Balaram. And so they are actually Vishnu Tattvas. But it took me many years before I realized that Advaita Acharya is also Vishnu Tattva, he is also the Lord. So that is a principle which is not now probably many know. But so why do we fast today? Because he's the Lord himself. He's Mahavishnu. He's actually, there's a story to how he has come, which is very pertinent to us, because His parents were Kuber Pandit. His father was Kuber Pandit, who was actually Kuber in the and a very devout follower of Lord Shiva. And his mother, Labha Devi, so she had a dream, and in the dream she saw Lord Sadashiv, who is the original form of Lord Shiva, was extremely, you can say, despondent because of the state of the world, and he went to the causal ocean, the banks of the causal ocean, where Lord Vishnu is, you know, eternally resting in his mystic slumber. And Lord Sadashiv, you know, beseeched the Lord Vishnu and did a lot of tapasya for 700 years. And then Lord Mahavishnu came to Lord Shiva and said that, you know, why did you need to do these austerities? We are one. And so then the Lord Shiva said that, you know, look at the state of the world, and how can we do anything unless I have your blessings? So then Mahavishnu embraced him. And then the product of their joint vision, that means both Advaita Acharya came in, so he's actually both Mahavishnu as well as Lord Sadashiv. So, you know, he's not just an ordinary pure devotee, he's actually the Lord himself. And then he had many firsts to his name, because he was the first to recognize that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is, Nimai is Lord Chaitanya, who's Krishna himself. And he was very bold, he proclaimed it. He was already 52 years old when Lord Chaitanya came, and he stayed 25 years more than Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on this world. So he actually stayed about 123 years. So it is said that though they show him with a beard, but he was eternally youthful. He also showed the attributes. He was very, bodily, he never looked 125 years old, 123 years old when he departed. He had six children. His eldest, Achyutanand, was the greatest of them all. And he had also, in his pastimes were also very similar to Krishna's and Chaitanya Nimai's pastimes. That means he was also quite mischievous in a very loving way. The one famous one is that when he refused to drink milk, when he was, because his mother would not chant Hare Krishna. So till she chanted Hare Krishna, then only he started taking the milk. And then later, when Nimai was born, same thing, Nimai was also refusing to take milk from his mother. And it was a big problem. Everybody was worried as to why this is happening. So then, since Advaita Acharya was very well-known person, and also he was close to the family, and everyone respected him, so they called him. And he immediately recognized the problem. He understood that actually because his Nimai's parents were not initiated, so it was unoffered milk, so therefore Nimai was not taking it. So on the spot then he actually, Advaita Acharya is the one who actually initiated Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Mata. So he's their guru in fact. And immediately after that, Nimai started taking the milk because then it was offered, because then she was initiated. He also enjoyed bewildering people with his divine powers. This was when he was a child. And many of his pastimes were in the mood of Shiva, Rudra, you know, with so-called anger, you know, and, externally. So once a couple of occasions when he was with the prince, prince was his friend. The prince was the son of King Divyasena, who ruled that place. So just jokingly, the prince started mocking devotees. And Advaita Acharya did not speak anything. He was also small. At that time, they used to be called Kamalaksha. That was his other name, lotus-eyed one. And Advaita name was given because he is non-different from the Lord. So when he was, Kamalaksha was also small, but just the way he glared at the prince just fainted. So he had that kind of inner power which could really straighten anyone up. Another time is the prince, and he had gone to some temple, and Advaita Acharya refused to bow down to Durga, and the prince got upset. It was his friend, but he got upset. Then he told the king got upset. Then they called Advaita's father, Kuber Pandit, had to explain to him. And then but he didn't relent. At that time, the deity, Durga's deity, actually the deity cracked, and a huge voice boomed out that the husband never bows down to the wife. So immediately understood that Durga is saying that this is Lord Shiva, so he's not supposed to bow down. So the king immediately apologized. He got initiated also. He became a Vaishnava when he was initiated by Advaita Acharya later. He was also a very brilliant student. He was mastering subjects which even people who were double his age could not do it. Of course, he met Madhavendra Puri when he was in his teens, and they had a deep love. It was instant connection, and he took initiation from him. He actually gave many pastimes of the Lord to his guru later. And Madhavendra Puri was the one who told him that you should get married because then you'd be able to take care of the deities better. So he got married to Sita Thakurani and then her sister Sridevi, and he had 6 children from them. And of course, Sita Thakurani is Yogamaya. So they said it's a perfect match, you know, Yogamaya and Mahavishnu. So he was also the first to worship the Lord. I recognize him as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Because he was also, he was very eager, very humble, so he was very eager to take the dust of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's feet. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would always respect him because of his seniority and his wisdom. So externally, because he was 52 years older, so when, you know, it is, but yet he never considered himself biologically older. He wanted to, so one day he actually enacted a kind of drama wherein he pretended to be a Mayavadi, and he started for some time extolling virtues of Mayavad, and he started talking about those philosophies, and then word got round to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and of course he understood, but externally showed a lot of anger, he and Nityanand Prabhu, and then they went there, and then they asked him 3 times that which is better, you know, personalism or impersonalism, and you know, he Advaita Acharya said impersonalism. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in pretending that mock anger, I mean, he really got angry, and he actually started pounced on him and he started beating him until Sita Thakurani please begged forgiveness, saying that, you know, he's an old man, please, you know, leave him. And then Advaita Acharya was in ecstasy because this is what he wanted, because that's how he could, you know, get. He wanted to be treated as a, he felt himself as a servant of the Lord, but not as if the respect that he was given. Of course, then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a bit embarrassed. This is all externally shown because he, you know, then he knew after he spoke. And then his disappearance also, Advaita Acharya Prabhu's disappearance also was, he was, as I mentioned, he stayed 25 years after Lord Chaitanya left. So those 25 years basically was extremely, he was in great separation right through. And then when the time for him to depart came, he called his disciples, some of his disciples, some of his children also came. And then there was an ecstatic, rapturous kirtan going. And in that, he suddenly went to the deity room, and then his deity, Sri Madan Gopalji, was there, and he just never came back to that. He just merged into the deity. But it is also not very well known that Advaita Acharya Prabhu was the cause of the Lord's descent into the world. That we know, because he was the one who actually went to the Ganges and prayed to the Lord, you know, in a very, very strong, you know, and helpless way, and the Lord actually fulfilled his desire and came. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came. But it is less known that he was also the cause of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to disappear from the world. So when the time had come, he wrote a poem which is very enigmatic, in the sense it was not very well understood except by Swarup Damodar and perhaps Jagadanand Pandit and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in the poem he wrote that rice is no longer needed in the marketplace because everyone has become like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself. You know, everyone is intoxicated with love of Krishna. So most were bewildered, but the message was that mission is accomplished. You know, everything is, now people have taken to chanting. Now this Yuga golden age has started. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left. So this is the importance of Advaita Acharya, that he has many firsts to his name. The first to recognize Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as a Krishna himself, the cause of his appearance, cause of his disappearance, and he was also the, he initiated his parents, he initiated Yadunanda. He had many other disciples, including Yadunandan Acharya, who was the guru of Raghunandas Goswami, Vasudev Dutt, and among others. So today it's a special day. So we'll end on that. Hare Krishna.